What's up, YouTube? It's the Action Figure Grader coming back to you with another video. I saw a really interesting article online that got me thinking more broadly about the collecting environment that we're in for any collectible, whether it's comics or action figures or whatever it is that you collect. And the article that got me thinking about it was by Go Collect. Go Collect is focused on comics. And if you're a comic collector and you don't know about it, I'd be surprised because it's a fairly well-known website. But you know, they have different bloggers that, you know, like to post articles, and one just got posted a couple days ago, and it's titled "How Much Should New Collectors Be Investing in Comics?" Well, I'm not going to focus solely on comics because I think that this question can apply to whatever you collect. I certainly mainly collect action figures, although I've gotten into some comics here recently, mainly due to space. I'm just running out of space in my collection room. And I thought, you know, comics would be kind of a cool thing to just, you know, collect as a different change of pace type thing. But I get this question quite a bit, and I have a number of different new collectors that like to reach out to me by Instagram or wherever. And they're asking about what should I buy, where should I buy, things like that. And I think that a lot of the points raised in this article can be applied to whatever you collect. And I have some thoughts beyond the article that I wanted to share as well. So first, let's just kind of briefly go through some of the talking points in the article. And then I've got some other stuff I want to kind of use as ancillary evidence to kind of talk about that. So it says, where should you invest your hard-earned money? Or if you've chosen to invest your hard-earned money in comics, how much? And he's talked about how ultra-high net worth investors allocate their investments and what percentage of their assets get put into collectibles. And you'll notice in the thumbnail for this video, I put invest in quotation marks. If you're a longtime viewer of my channel, I kind of view collectibles as just that. I just collect because I like to collect. It's not like an investment for me. Certainly, it would be nice that whenever I do have to sell stuff, that they would go up in value. But if they don't, I don't care. And I think that's where a lot of the mistakes are for a lot of new folks entering the collectibles market. They see all of the big boom going on with collectibles and the prices jumping 100, 200, 300%. And they're like, I want to get mine. I want to get my money. I want to buy some stuff and flip it and so forth. And I think I would caution you on that because I think that those days are numbered, if not already passed. We've had a lot of folks, at least here in the U.S. and I'm sure globally, who have allocated discretionary income to things other than what they're used to. So, you know, they're used to going out, they're used to spending a certain percentage of their money, of their discretionary flexible spending on going out, live events, vacations, all that kind of stuff. And for the last year, they haven't been doing that. So to a certain extent, a large driver of the collectibles market has been the fact that folks have extra money that they're not putting towards the normal items that they've done in past years. And that's coming to an end very quickly as people get back to normalcy. And we're going to talk about some more data points on that here in a little while that will be absolutely shocking, especially if you're here in the U.S. But, you know, so keep that in mind that I think that the peak of the appreciation that we're seeing, these drastic jumps, certainly there'll be exceptions as, you know, new hot properties get announced. Things like The Mandalorian brought back into the fold old collectors that have been kind of, I don't know, turned off by the latest trilogy of films. And so, hey, I'm back in it now. I really enjoyed The Mandalorian. Well, how much are the new programs going to be on Disney Plus? Any new movies? How much are those going to continue to drive those, let's call it, casual collectors that are not in it for the long haul, like me, you know, who I don't particularly care what media comes out for Star Wars. I'm going to be collecting Star Wars stuff. But for every one of me, there's probably like 50 or 100 casual collectors who might buy a couple of things here and there and have dipped their toes back into the collecting market in more earnest after their enjoyment of The Mandalorian. So that's going to be interesting to see what happens there. And the article goes on to talk about if how much of your assets should you put in collectibles. And they're saying that ultra high net worth investors, I'm highlighting as I talk here, they tend to allocate between 5% and 20% of their investable assets in investment grade collectibles. More on that in a second, the investment grade portion. But I'm going to go ahead and tell you right now that I think putting 20% of your assets, of your income, or whatever number you're looking at, your net worth in collectibles is complete insanity. There's no way that I would do that. No way. That is way too high. And especially if you are a new collector, 5% is probably even too high if I were you. New collectors need to be very cautious because prices are high right now. And I would really take your time. I've preached patience in past videos where I've seen something I really want and it was just too high, or the bidding got too high on eBay, or the price being asked on Facebook was too high, and I was patient. And I've had other cases where I've overpaid because I specifically wanted that item. So new collectors should be very careful, but if you're, especially if you're a new collector, and especially if you are not, which most 99% of us are not ultra high net worth individuals. I certainly am not one, but there's no way that I would put 20% of my assets. 5%, maybe 10%, but even 10% is probably way too high. So keep that in mind. Now the other part of this article talks about investment grade. He says this doesn't mean average grades. This would be the best of the best. It also means they would remove their primary residence from calculating these investments. So I do agree that if you are a collector and you're specifically collecting for the investment potential, investment grade is probably the way to go. I do it because I enjoy it. I enjoy getting stuff graded. I enjoy having really high grade stuff. But your budget, you have to adjust your collecting based on your budget. If you have a very limited budget, there's nothing wrong with that. Just buy what you like. That first and foremost, that's most important. But if you are collecting because you're looking at this as an investment, that's fine. That's your right to do that. But I would say that less items that are higher grade make more sense to me than buying a bunch of 70. You know, let's say we're talking specifically about graded items, graded action figures. Buying 10 70 grade loose graded Star Wars vintage figures versus two or three 85 to 90 grade vintage Star Wars figures, there's no comparison. I would take the fewer higher grade items than I would a larger multiples of lower grade items. That's just my personal opinion. There's certainly exceptions. There's always exceptions to any rule. And if you're talking about ultra rare items, you know, for example, I have several Spanish figures, Spanish Star Wars figures, loose graded, that are very difficult to find. And they're only like 70, 75 grade. And I'm okay with that because it's just so hard to find those. And even finding one that's an 85 or a 90 grade would be next to impossible. They just don't exist. So for those, it's okay to have lower grade, but you're increasing your rarity. So I hope that makes sense. But that would be my first piece of advice. And I see a lot of collectors make that mistake. Early on, when I started collecting graded items, I was very calculated about what I started getting. My very first item was an AFA 85 Darth Vader because I love Darth Vader. And in general, I've tend, with the exception of bootlegs or with very rare foreign figures, I tend to stay high grade, 80, 85, 90, things like that. And I'm glad I did because I do see a lot of collectors who reach out to me and show me their photos of their collection and things like that. And it's cool. You know, I'm not, this is not me disparaging them, but I would not buy a 70 grade normal everyday Hong Kong Darth Vader when there's like a millions of those that are ungraded that you could get. You're better off spending more money or the same amount of money and just budgeting and you know, getting one 85 grade figure instead of five 70 grade figures. So hopefully that makes sense, but that would be my recommendation. But so again, it also talks about as a new collector, you might consider setting yourself a monthly budget. And that is a key. I don't consider myself a new collector anymore, but I certainly set a monthly budget every month. And there's some months where I'm disgusted with myself and I'm disgusted with how much stuff I have, and I don't spend anything. I just don't want to spend anything. And then I have other months where I might spend more than what my allocation is. But I think the key is to come up with a monthly number that you can live with and set it aside, whether you keep it in your PayPal or keep it in your Venmo account or, or some other kind of separate account other than where you pull your expenses from. And, the good thing is that sometimes I have unexpected expenses. I'm in real estate, so sometimes like a water heater will blow up and I've got to set aside 500, $600 to put it in a brand new water heater. Well, I usually pull it from my collecting money. A water heater for one of my rental properties is a lot more important than buying a comic. You know what I mean? So it's nice to have a rainy day account anyway. I mean, I always recommend having a 3 to 6 month living expenses set aside. And, for me personally, last year that came in handy when I couldn't show real estate and my wife was laid off, because of everything that was going on. And that kind of emergency fund, so to speak, really helped a lot during those 6 months where things were a little bit dicey. So, but in terms of your budget, I mean, I really do think that setting a budget is important. And for me, I set aside a budget for not only any new acquisitions, whether they're action figures or vintage collection or something vintage or a comic book or whatever. But I also include grading costs for those of you that actually do send stuff in to get graded with AFA or CAS or UKG. You got to include those costs. You got to include shipping costs to and from the facilities. So there's a lot of different things that you got to factor in into your budget for collecting. And that's really important to do. I'll say this. I'm gonna show a couple other things here, but this is a really interesting article, and I encourage you to go to collect.com and check it out. There's some other points that he makes, but if you're a new collector and you're thinking about getting into collectibles as an investment, my only caution to you is, do you have any debt? If you have debt right now, specifically credit card debt, you should not be looking at collectibles at all. You need to pay off that credit card debt. And this is not me trying to tell you what to do with your money. This is just my personal advice on it. But if you look at on this next tab, the average American family has credit card debt right now of over $6,000. That's a massive number. The total outstanding consumer debt is $4.2 trillion, $807 billion of credit card debt. 45% of families carry some sort of credit card debt. Credit cards, folks, they have an interest rate of almost 20%. Some of them higher than that. Some of them like 25%. So every month, just by carrying that credit card debt, you're paying 25% of whatever your balance is to the credit card companies for that right. So if you have credit card debt, get that paid off first before you even start thinking about investing in collectibles. Because every dollar that you pay off of your credit card debt, that's an automatic 20 to 25% return on your money. That's a massive number and probably better than you're ever going to do in the collectibles environment right now, given that we're towards the upper end of the current collectibles bubble, in my opinion. I just don't see a massive 25% run up from here to, in the next 6 months. Maybe it happens, maybe it doesn't. No one can predict the future. But this is a guaranteed return on your money. So if you got $500 and you're thinking about buying a rare action figure, but you're sitting on $2,000 of credit card debt, pay off the credit card debt. And that $500 automatically gives you a 20 to 25% return, depending on what your credit card interest rate is. So that's number one. But these numbers were pretty staggering when I looked at the average credit card debt of the US family. And I just thought it was worth sharing that. So if you fall into this category, and apparently 45.4% of Americans do fall into this category, you got to get that paid off first before you start talking about other investments. Some other points that I want to make are, I think that right now we're at the very beginning of post 2020 and everything that happened with lockdowns and so forth. We're kind of just starting to kind of reemerge from that cocoon, right? And the numbers that came out here recently were pretty amazing. It talks about, this is just the US now, it talks about job openings. And look at this number, look at this chart. Right now, there are 9.3 million jobs available in the US. So that means that people are not going back to work, even though there are jobs there. And so what does that mean? And how does this tie into collectibles? Well, number one, people are sitting at home collecting unemployment, they're collecting other kinds of benefits right now. And at some point, those benefits are going to run out. We just, you know, the U.S. economy does not have the money to pay that in perpetuity. It's just we've already spent trillions and trillions of dollars. And with 9.3 million available jobs right now, this signifies that businesses are ready to get back to expansion and start growing again. And, you know, so the collectibles market could go one of two ways. With more people getting back to work and filling these 9.3 million jobs, they're going to have more discretionary income than maybe they do right now. Maybe right now they're at home, they're not even looking for a new job, and they're relying solely on federal assistance. Well, if they get back to work and they have more discretionary income, potentially the collectibles market could go up even further than it has right now because they got more play money. But the other thing is businesses that are in the industries where discretionary income comes into play, such as tourism, hotels, rental cars, restaurants, live events, sports, you know, sports businesses, things like that. Those businesses are just ramping up, let's say. And as those vacancies get filled and they can start producing more of their either products or services that Americans will use their discretionary income on, then potentially the collectibles market goes the other way. So it all depends on where those 9.3 million jobs are, what industries, if that makes sense. You know, so I think that as those vacancies fill over the next 6 to 15 months, it's gonna have an effect of some sort on the collectibles market. It's just hard to tell which. If I had to guess, I personally think that as our economy gets back to normal and people get back to normal and start spending on other things other than just sitting at home and collecting toys or comics or whatever you collect, I think the collectibles market's going to flatten, personally. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. I'm not Nostradamus of action figures, but I think that was worth pointing out. The other thing that I wanted to point out is that, you know, this is another chart that just shows kind of the massive availability of jobs. This is job availability right now in the U.S. We got 9.3 million jobs available, but not filled. And, you know, this is the job openings are up 32% over pre-crisis levels. That is a massive number. So with a 30% jump versus even before what happened last year, it just, to me, it's a hint. This is an early hint that we're going to be getting back to normal soon and that the economy could boom even more. But how that plays into how Americans spend their money, that's what's going to affect the collectibles market. You know, collectibles are basically discretionary income, right? We take our play money, or, you know, unless you're like an ultra net worth, high net worth individual who wants to allocate money to investment grade collectibles, most of us, we kind of use discretionary play money or, you know, non-normal living expense money to collectibles. And it's just going to be really interesting to see what happens as the economy opens back up in earnest, and whether that has a positive or negative effect on collectibles. I tend to think it's going to have a negative effect, but we'll see. Anyway, I thought that was an interesting article that got me thinking more broadly about not only comics, but just collectibles in general. And I hope that it was thought-provoking for you. If you enjoyed this kind of content, I encourage you to like and comment below and subscribe if you're new. And I want to say thank you for watching.